Welcome to Layer the Alchemist, where we discuss all things heavy metal and hard rock, and welcome to another edition of Sabbath Sunday. This is where Darren and I get together with you to discuss all things Black Sabbath, and this is part two of our 10 favorite Black Sabbath album covers, ranking our 10 favorite Black Sabbath album covers. Part one, we did 10 through 6, and now we are going to do 5 through 1. All right, Darren, everybody's been on the edge of their seats from last week. You almost gave away your number 5 pick at the end there.
I know.
Here in suspense, wondering what your number 5 pick is. So go ahead and give it to us.
Yeah, I mean, I left a cliffhanger there. talking about the photographer, Keith McMillan, who did the, we were talking about Master of Reality and the poster that came inside of that. The photographer was Keith McMillan, otherwise known as Keef, K-E-E-F. He also took this photograph, which was rendered in a monochrome, saturated finished product. And of course, this logo, very iconic. It's a no-frills affair. It's kind of similar to Master of Reality in that regard. But like what you said about Master of Reality with stoner rock bands and stuff trying to ride the coattails of Black Sabbath to get their point across. Like, say, for instance, hypothetically, the band Bong Lord would have their, just to make sure that they didn't have to do too much work, they would have their logo Bong Lord using the the typography from either Volume 4 of Master of Reality. That's how iconic it is. So if you want to get a point across that you play music similar to Black Sabbath or something within the stoner rock genre, you're very easy, or you're very predisposed probably to borrow from one of these two album covers. And that's kind of what makes, that puts it in my top 5, actually, top 5. In addition to that, you know, you have the opposite color scheme here. Just to go in a little bit further with this really cool package from Vertigo Records.
Yeah.
Now you got like the gatefold here, cool pictures of the bands. It's really cool in the 70s when record labels would do this. They also did it for Your Eye Heap Live. There's a book, pictures, kind of like a little tour book type of thing, even though it's not a live album, but you know, it gives you more bang for the buck. So, I mean, not only is the album cover very simplistic, but striking, gets the message across, but it's a nice package as well. So Volume 4, number 5 for me.
All right, well, I'm going to follow up with you. My number 5 is also Volume 4. Like you said, this is one of the really iconic images also from their album covers. The Master of Reality, Black Sabbath, wavy logo is very iconic. And then this image of Ozzy flashing the peace signs is also, I think, super iconic. And like you said, it's another signifier. You put this color scheme together, you write your band name the same way with the same font. And, you know, it just screams doom and stoner and Black Sabbath worship. And it's a cool cover. And you can see the original picture in the Black Sabbath Volume 4 Super Deluxe box set. You can see the original photo of Ozzy before they colored it in and did what they did to it. So
yeah, actually they colored Tony Iommi out of it. They see Tony Iommi is just next to him, or just in the background, and they kind of blacken him out just so that you have that picture of Ozzy, which is really cool. That was like the similar, I guess, in some ways to Dio's flashing the horns, the Ozzy, the peace sign.
Yeah.
Ozzy was like, that was their thing. It was kind of like,
it's sort of this iconic Ozzy.
Yeah. He was like their mascot. Yeah. Ozzy was the mascot. So.
Okay. Number 4.
Number 4 for me, Black Sabbath, Heaven and Hell. It's a very elegant album cover. You're looking at things like, well, of course, what would come later would be Born Again, where it's a little bit more garish. This is very elegant. And actually, it wasn't created specifically for this album. The artist's name is Lynn Curley. And Lynn Curley also did another iconic album cover by a different band, but just for shits and giggles, we'll share this one too. The story was that things weren't working out with the band's original concept for the album cover. So the record label contacted Lynn Curley, probably based off of the success and publicity that Agents of Fortune by BOC was getting or had gotten, and contacted the artist, thought he had something in mind, and the band already had the title Heaven and Hell when the picture, the painting of the Smoking Angels came in. Perfect fit. The artist sent the art to the record label, and the next thing he knew, he got a check, so he was accepted. So, rightfully so. Also, the back cover is really cool. That, like, again, an elegant package with the band, which originally was a photograph with Ozzy. Ozzy was in the center, and Geezer was on one side. Ozzy was flanked by Bill and Geezer, and they kind of shifted things around when they did the drawing of the photograph, putting Dio in there, chilling there. But again, adds into the album, which was, you know, as we all know, was a new era for the band. Very elegantly presented in this album cover. And just a cool album cover. The Angel Smoking, the irony.
Absolutely. All right, number four for me is the first album, the self-titled album. Sets the mood, in my opinion, perfectly for this record for Black Sabbath. I always thought the logo was really cool. The witch in front of the house. I forgot to write this down. This is an actual place, a water mill, and I don't remember the name of the town, but it's still there. And Black Sabbath fans, whenever they're in the area, it's a photo op that every Black Sabbath fan has to take if you're anywhere near where this is, because it's so iconic.
And in Dayton, Ohio, I think, isn't it in Dayton, Ohio? Is it in Dayton, Ohio? I'm just kidding.
Yeah. And the model on the front for ages was a complete mystery. People thought it's that Ozzy. Nobody knew what was going on here. And this model resurfaced just a couple of years ago, came out and said she was the person on the cover. She was just somebody that they hired from an agency. She showed up. She said it was cold outside, but the woods, the house, the sort of water in front of it, the moat or whatever in front of it, just gives it this super creepy atmosphere. There's something about forests that, you know, can be scary. It gives it sort of a Hammer horror, 70s horror vibe to it. So just an absolutely legendary, fantastic album cover. And that comes in at number four for me.
So number three for me, and you already presented it, but Live Evil. Yeah, I mean, you pointed out already, but all the different characters on the front represent the songs within the album. And it was fun when I was a kid trying to figure out which ones were which. Well, some were pretty obvious. We have War Pigs here, you know, getting a glare, but the War Pigs. You got, obviously, it's Mob Rules. I guess we could say Heaven and Hell. But anyway, Voodoo, of course, we got Voodoo, that little character there. The guy in a straitjacket. It wouldn't be Am I Going Insane, because it's not on the album, so it would have to be Paranoid, I guess.
Yeah, maybe Paranoid, yeah.
But, the realistic vibe of this album cover was really pretty cool. It was done by, the artist's name is Stan Watts. And Stan Watts also did another popular album cover. I'm not sure, I guess it was about a year later or so. Quiet Riot, Mental Health. He did that, and also Condition Critical.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Yeah. So, Live Evil. Probably one of the best Black Sabbath album covers, I think. I wish I liked the album more, but it doesn't hurt to have a great album cover.
Yeah.
Three copies of it.
Yeah.
Good album.
All right. Number three, you mentioned this one already, Mob Rules. What can you say about this? It's kind of scary. I can remember seeing it for the first time, sitting there on the shelf in the record store. the way the logo is sort of like spray painted on a wall, there is that blood that they use, these faceless guys here, and this image on the front. It kind of, I always thought of it as the shroud of, what is that called? The shroud of
Turin.
Turin. Yeah, you know, that kind of like,
yeah,
or maybe a reference to that. And like you said, the stuff written down underneath here. And the title of this particular painting is from 1971, and it's called Dream One Crucifiers. And I got to see this somewhere. I don't remember where I saw this. I saw this in an art gallery somewhere, and it was very cool. So
I actually have the promo poster, the Warner Brothers promo poster, hanging up on my wall just over yonder. It's like 42 by 26. Nice big poster. Looks really cool on my wall.
I forgot too, I always liked these drains.
Yeah.
Sort of in the back here, sort of driven, like these guys are sort of living in a tunnel
or something.
Yeah, exactly. They're like, you know, dwelling beneath everybody here. And so I always thought that was
cool. And again, the cool thing about it is that the artist Greg Hildebrand, he did a lot of fantasy stuff, a lot of very whimsical. Nothing as gritty or as what I guess you could consider violent, you know, based on the blood and, you know, the overall like vibe of it. Most of the stuff he's done has been really far removed from that album cover. So it's kind of remarkable that, mm-hmm. that, you know, he did that, and it's become so iconic and sort of ironic because most of his body of work is for like, he did a Star Wars movie poster and a lot of J.R.R. Tolkien stuff, calendars, book covers, things like that. So.
And if I remember correctly, when I saw it art gallery, there was a little bit more on the sides, and I don't remember the top, but I just think I remember there being just a little bit more, like it was cropped a little bit for the album cover, so it was kind of cool to see it in a little bit of an expanded form. But okay, number two, what do you got for your number two?
Number two, I have a feeling that I'm stealing your number one. Am I right?
Maybe.
I'll find out. Wow, what an album cover. On any level, that's an amazing album cover. It's the Teutonic logo, Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath, is awesome. The art itself is awesome. The skull leaning over the bed, the tortured guy laying there, presumably dying with the demons all around them. And then on the back, completely opposite, even with the color scheme is very warm, kind of, well, not warm in a soothing way, kind of, you know, I guess you could say aggressive color scheme somewhat. And of course back, the blue, soothing, kind of the opposite, he's more relaxed. I don't know what's going on, but sort of the opposite of the front. But the front cover, man, really cool. Couldn't wait to get this album. But it wouldn't matter. I mean, of course, it's an awesome album, but there are certain album covers that I had to buy regardless of what the music sounded like. This was one. Merciful Fate, Don't Break the Oath was another. Of course, that's another fantastic album. Iron Maiden Killers had an incredible album cover. Awesome album, too. But this one, yeah, it's really, really cool. Also, you have a European pressing or maybe one of the reissues. Get to see the band.
A psychedelic.
Yeah. And this was at, this photograph was taken at the, what was the name of the, we've talked about it so many times, but the studio where they recorded. Do you remember?
No.
Zeppelin was also there too, I believe. Anyway, that was in the, one of the rooms, one of the bedrooms in the studio. That picture was taken, but Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath.
Awesome.
Yeah,
cool. All right, number two, you mentioned this one already, Heaven and Hell. So I agree with everything that you said. I think that this cover, it has a very sort of sophisticated feel to it. And it sort of ushers in this era of the band. It's I always think it's a little more artsy. It's a little bit more serious, you know, if you will. And I think it's reinforced by the picture on the back, which always reminded me of the Long Live Rock and Roll album cover from Rainbow. But it's just this sort of like serious Sabbath moving into the 80s, new era of the band. They're not trying to pretend like they're not trying to they're wise old veterans at this point, you know, and it just sort of reflects, it's just a very mature album cover, you know, yet it still has a little bit of, you know, the cards and this and the smoking and everything. It gives it sort of that rock and roll edge, but just the way it's painted on here, or the way it looks with the black background and everything. And I'm a sucker for angel statues, anything with angels. So to me, that's just super, super cool. And I guess the original picture that this guy did, it was inspired by, he saw some girls at a pageant. And he, I don't know if he took a picture and then did it off of that and then added these big wings, you know, or something. It was at a Christmas pageant. So, but I just thought it just perfectly fits the, you know, where we were talking about Paranoid, where you're not really sure what's going on, you know, in the Paranoid album cover. This isn't the case here, you know, it really embodies the whole heaven and hell. Heaven is the angels, hell is the cards and the smoking. Entities living together. They're sort of like one in the same, if you will. So yeah. Just absolutely iconic.
And like I said, it was, it's coincidental and it's fate. Yeah. It wasn't created for the album, but it fits so well with the album title. And you're right. I mean, it does have that a throwback to Long Live Rock and Roll. Maybe Dio bought that idea to the tape.
Yeah,
but the other thing about that album that's really cool is you would think that it is kind of laid back. It does have a sophisticated, elegant look to it. And you would think that maybe for that period of time they may have opted to get something that was like more aggressive, more attention grabbing because of the lineup change and where they were by the time the dust settled after Never Say Die, and of course the lineup change. You would think that they'd have like some kind of a gimmick album cover or something that would, you know, really attract people to buy it. But now it was kind of laid back, so, you know, credit for that. It was confident, but, you know, still a Black Sabbath album cover. It's still tied in with the Black Sabbath concept or the aesthetics of Black Sabbath. So,
All right. So what do you got for your number one? I'm kind of going back to my head here and trying to guess what your number one is going to be, but I can't remember exactly the other ones you picked, but.
13. No.
Okay. Right. I haven't mentioned.
This is the cover. This is the cover of the End All Covers. It's mysterious. It's creepy. It's kind of scary. It's haunting. Everything you said, of course, I agree with. The font, you pointed out the font, that's a very iconic font, the Art Nouveau, I think it is. It wasn't a font that, or a letter form that was created for Black Sabbath, but yet it became associated with Black Sabbath.
Yeah.
Completely. I never saw it. I mean, I think it had been used on other things in and around that time, but of course it wasn't as recognizable with anything as it became for Black Sabbath.
And it's so iconic, I even use it for the Lair of the Alchemist logo.
Right.
Or Ruthless Metal made it for me. That's what I should say. He used that.
Yeah. Beyond that, so you'd mentioned that the location, it was actually, I wrote it down here because I knew I'd forget. Oh, and also this was, the photograph was done by Keith,
okay.
As we mentioned, his full name, Keith McMillan. And so the location is Maple Durham Water Mill. This is a water mill. It's not a slaughterhouse or anything like that, as it was rumored to be. It's a pretty mundane situation here with the water mill, because the water mill, so of course there's water in the front. You mentioned that a lot of people, it still exists, the structure is still there. The surrounding area is a little bit different. It's a little more clean, but, you know, some friends of ours, people that we know on Facebook, have, you know, made the pilgrimage to this site and got their pictures taken there, which I would like to do at some point someday. But the model was, nobody knew who it was. for many years. Her name, and I also wrote this down, Louise Livingstone was the model. And she was recognized, or I guess she came forth and owned up to it in 2020, a couple of years ago. There were some photos taken of her that she said that were like she was wearing something a little more risque, a little more revealing, but it was cold. And yeah. So she bundled up a little bit in between some of the photos. And of course, they ended up taking the photos anyway like that. And it worked out best because yeah. she's like, you know, like a witch.
She's very, yeah.
And yeah, her pose
indicates. Medieval witch look.
Yeah. And, you know, like you said, it kind of has a Hammer horror vibe to it. It definitely does. And she almost has like the way that they saturated this also adds into the artistic element. And she looks like she's green.
Yeah, yeah. And like it almost
greenish tint.
Yeah, and it almost gives it like a like the picture, somebody snapped this picture, like, you know, Bigfoot or something. Like they're there and they saw this woman and they snapped it and then she was gone.
Yeah.
After that. You know how like those type of pictures are always a little saturated from that, all those Bigfoot pictures. You know, this is the same thing. Like it wasn't intended. This woman was just standing there and somebody took her picture. And
no, you're right. Yeah. It has that, that spontaneity to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's really artistic, but it's become so iconic. I think, you know, we mentioned all these other album covers and some of them are just cool album covers. Conceptually, they're cool. They, you know, they serve the band really well. But the ones that are iconic, you know, we've already mentioned Master of Reality, Volume 4. This one definitely, I think, is probably the most iconic. And it's a great first album, great statement of intent. It's bluesy, it's heavy.
Yeah.
The album cover really suits the music very well. It's complete package. And
I would find it really fascinating.
Second pressing UK, not first, but second pressing.
It would be really cool and fascinating if they were to find some of the other photos from that photo session.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be amazing.
Cool to see them. Yeah. All right. If one touch, they wouldn't be, I'm assuming they wouldn't have that saturated color.
Just to see it maybe from different angles and some of the other shots they may have taken would be really interesting.
You know, it's funny when you have an album cover that's so visually rich, and listening to this album when I first got it, you know, like one of the things I always do is like the album cover was cool. You just listen to the music. If there's a gatefold, you open the gatefold. There's a lyric sheet. You take that out. You read the lyrics. You look at the pictures, whatever. I remember just staring at this album cover, the front of it, the back of it, and incorporating the images, especially in the back cover. I mean, I sometimes think I have a kind of a photographic memory. When I think of the songs like Warning, A Bit of Finger, Sleeping Village, in my mind, I see this back album cover. The crow sitting up there. Anyways, whenever I think of Sleeping Village, I think of that crow.
Yeah.
So that's a good album cover. The album cover stays in your memory, stays in your mind, and reminds you of certain song titles or certain songs or the music itself. It's pretty cool, pretty successful, I think.
Yeah, and woods can be scary places. You know, it makes me think of like the Blair Witch Project, that house in the middle of the woods. And of course, now we know that it's a water mill along the side of a main road.
Yeah.
But as a kid, I imagined this being somewhere, you know, in the middle of the woods, you know, completely isolated from everywhere else, this house all by itself. And you're right, that you put the album on and the rain and the bell and everything, it just all sort of fits in with that cover. All right, my number one. Well, you gave it away. You knew what I was going to pick. Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath. It's just so artistic. Everything that you said about it, I agree. As a young kid, it scared me. The 666 thing on the headboard there, and then sort of the mourning family members here on one side. And I always thought this was sort of like fire, you know, and brimstone, the demons on this side. And it's just fits the mood of the album, the title track. It's just very, I just remember seeing this and just being very scared. Like I had to hide this, you know, if I didn't want my parents to see it, you know, because it just seemed like it was evil. And it's just such a well done, scary cover. And like you said, the picture, this particular version doesn't have the gatefold, but just love it. So that lands at number one for me.
Yeah. And a little factoid about that. Artist's name was Drew. I also wrote this down, which I forgot to mention when I did my presentation.
Drew Sturin?
Struzan? I don't know how you pronounce it. Like, that's as good a guess as any. Struzan. Another guy that did movie covers or movie posters.
Yeah, it does look like that. It looks like a movie.
Yeah. That's mostly what he did. Some very recognizable ones. Raiders of the Lost Ark was one of them. You know, also for Star Wars, he did like Return of the Jedi, I think. Empire Strikes Back. You know,
so. All right, well, there you go. There's our 5-1 favorite Black Sabbath album covers. Let us know what you think of our top 5 picks. Let us know what your top 5 picks are down below, what some of your favorite Black Sabbath album covers are, what you thought about our picks. And we will see you at the next Sabbath Sunday.